special electrical energy. How they are ultimately made available to the consumers, and how the energy conversion process takes place at different stages, and the nature of voltages and currents, the whether it's DC or AC or a combination. So what we covered was fairly trivial, so I don't expect much of doubts from you. Just to reassure myself, can you tell me what was the power generating capacity in India in 1947? Okay, so what, right, what is it now? That's fine. Okay, now in a large electrical network, what does it consist of? Just one at a time, please. Utilization. So you are aware that there is a source, the generation, transmission, distribution, utilization. That is the all the same. Okay. Now the devices that we are talking about in this subject, what is the frequency of operation? 50 to 60 hertz. So what is the typical maximum power ranges we can talk about in this? Do you have an idea? So they are in megawatt ranges up to. Okay. And the currents could be in kiloamperes, and voltages megavolts range. Fine. Now, why is the AC preferred to DC?
Because of the conversion of voltage levels, sir. Because it's easier to convert the voltage levels to one another.
Yeah.
Ease of generation, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Distribution. Ease of distribution.
Okay. So we have said that AC was frozen as a useful system of generation, transmission, and utilization. And of late, we have a combination also being attempted in a few places, because bulk power can also be efficiently transmitted through DC, through HVDC. Okay. Now, we also have learnt about the DC networks, which you already know, and we went to about the AC circuits. Okay, and in AC circuits, we defined certain terminologies, the peak value, the RMS value, the average value, the period of a say wave, then what is the frequency, and how they are interrelated. And then we went on, because of the complexity of time varying quantities to be analyzed, we use a concept called a phasor. Okay. And a phasor, we said, for any quantity to be represented by a phasor, we had two important conditions. What were those conditions? Just a minute.
Fixed frequency and
sinusoidal variation. These two are absolutely necessary. Okay. Now, what is the magnitude of a phasor that you represent? Can you tell? Just a minute. Any AC quantity to be represented by a phasor, what is the magnitude of that phasor?
Peak upon root 2.
That is called?
The RMS value.
Okay. So, you always represent a phasor by its RMS value. And will the phasor be in any specific direction, or it can have any direction? The phasor of an AC quantity, will it be oriented towards any specific direction, or X or Y axis, or anywhere? Huh? It is a rotating vector, but then if it is rotating, it is difficult to analyze. How do we actually represent it? Just a minute, one at a time. So you freeze it at time t equal to 0 and say that is the phasor that you represent. Okay. So we said yesterday the phasor representation of an AC quantity And we said that if there is a phasor of a quantity A, which can be represented by its root 2 times A into cos omega t. So, we have this is A. And we said that this can also be written as root 2 times real part of A e to the power of j omega t. And we represent this as the phasor A. Phasor of the quantity A, we do which represents, which it goes with time. And we write that phasor A will be in this case A plus J0, and we represent like this. And whose magnitude will be A. Then we said if we have another phasor, let us say B is root 2 times the RMS value into cos of omega t, but at some other angle, say phi. So we have to write its magnitude may be different and phase shift is different. So it is having a peak value which will go like okay. So the peak value of the B wave will be coming after the peak value of the A wave, and there is always, and the zero of the B wave will be coming after a time interval phi from the A wave. Okay. So we write this in this form, and if you want to put it in this way, we write root 2 times real of B e to the power of minus j phi into e to the power of j omega t. That's what we did yesterday. So we consider this as phasor of the quantity B. Okay. And the next quantity B would be, this is the phi B phasor, and we can write B phasor will be B e to the power of minus j phi, which will be B cos phi minus j B sin phi, or it will have its real part Bx plus j By. Okay. And the B phasor will therefore lag the A phasor by an angle phi. Okay. So we have said that this simply means I am taking this phasor, I go on rotating at omega radians per second in the anti-clockwise pattern, and the magnitude at any instant will be root 2 times the real part of that at that instant, each of the phases. So in any large network of several current, several voltages, we could still represent all of them in terms of phases, because you will have a cluster of several waveforms displaced at any arbitrary angles between them. Okay, so they all can be represented by the phasors. So there could be several voltage phasors, there could be several current phasors. Okay, so I think this is a physical the concept you must be clear about. If you are clear at this point, you will not get the doubt later. And you may be interested to know, in electrical engineering, we always use a term J. What is this term J? J is e to the power of J pi by 2. Okay? Again, you have put brought another J here. Right? Which means, if it is an operator J, which will, any real quantity will be made imaginary. Okay? So you are, if it is real, A, J A will become like this. And what will be J square A will become? Minus 1. And J cube A will become? Minus J. Okay? So,
what do we mean by imaginary voltages and
currents? That means you started getting imaginary doubts. We have made it very that it is a representation of the time varying quantity. We are only representing it. Okay? So it is only a phasor is a representation of the time varying quantity, and in actual reality it will have a specific voltage at that instant. So then you have to do this operation back. Nothing is imaginary. Okay? Everything is real. Right? This thing you must get it clear. So therefore we know that the standard this thing like J square is minus 1. J cubed is minus J, and J to the power of 4 is 1. Okay? This is this operation. And you may know that in some other subjects like physics, they use I. Right? And in electrical engineering, they use J. Can you imagine what could be the reason? Okay, electrical engineers are always flooded with I for current. So you can't afford to lose that I for current. Because I seems to be important. Okay? Right. Now, let us understand the response of AC voltage, single phase AC system, we have always said if you apply a voltage, current will result. For the current to result, there must be a network. Okay? So, response to standard passive elements. Again, this you must have done, but this is a question of completeness. Okay. Now, we are interested to know if you apply AC voltage to different elements, how do they respond? Okay. A simplest element that you know is the resistance. So, if I have a voltage source maybe you can apply sine or cosine, doesn't matter, it is a matter of I apply a voltage like this, sinusoidal, 0 pi by 2. And to a resistance element. Okay. So I apply this voltage. Okay. and it will result in a current. Simple. And what is a definition of a resistance? First, we should know what is resistance. By definition, resistance is, that is not the definition. It is a ratio of the voltage across a conducting part to the current at DC steady state. Okay? So that is by definition. By definition, R is the ratio of voltage to current. Of a conducting part under DC steady state. So we give this as a specific definition of a resistance, and therefore we can write that V is equal to Ri, or R is equal to V by I. Okay. And you have already applied a voltage, so it is very simple. Voltage we have already applied, which is equal to root 2 times V, let us say in this case cos omega t, and we will get I will be root 2 times V by R cos omega t by definition, right? And so you can write a V phasor. What will be V phasor and I phasor? So you will have an I that will go like this, and if this is root 2 times the RMS value, this will be root 2 times the V by R. Okay. So it's very easy to note that V phasor, if you write like this, the I phasor will be also in the same direction, because we write V as, from this we write root 2 times real part of V into e to the power of j omega t, and we write I as root 2 times real part of V by R e to the power of j omega t, or root 2 times real part of I e to the power of j omega t. What is the I am representing equal to V by R? When I say so, we have defined V as the RMS voltage, and I will be RMS current. Okay. So you be very clear that what we are talking ultimately is the RMS voltage current, and we have, from this we have drawn a phasor diagram V in line with current. So we can always write the V in a resistive network, V will be always equal to R into I. I always follows V. It will be every instant it will be like this, and it will take up the magnitude at each instant. At each instant the magnitude will be V by R. That is important. At each instant. Okay. And so even instant as a resistance is occurred, and each instant that holds good. Okay. Now what is the value of a resistance? It's a certain part is conductors, and we have always said the type of systems we are looking are basically a good conductors. We can't afford to have semi good conductors, you know, in transmitting power. You want good conductors, perhaps you may prefer superconductors. Okay. So how does the resistance is decided of a conducting part? What decides the resistance of a part? Resistivity, then dimensions. Okay. So a resistance of a component or a part is decided by design. Okay. So that is important. So resistance is decided by design. You design a resistance. In electronic systems, you design a resistance. In heavy current or power systems, you design a resistance. That is one thing. Or by your, whether you like it or not, there is a resistance available on the system. You don't design it for a resistance. You make a motor with several turns, and then but your resistance exists because of the very property of the material. Therefore, if you have a part whose resistance you want to know, okay, and which has a length L and a cross-sectional area A, okay, and the material property rho, then its resistance you would like to know. What is the resistance of that component? And you may already know that resistance is equal to rho L by A, where rho is the resistivity of the material. This is a material property. And we normally assume, though it may often not be true, that normally assume that resistivity is constant at all points in the body of the material. Okay. So resistivity, what is its unit? Ohm meter, and length will be in length in meter, and A is area in meter square. Okay, this is a very simple concept which you already know. So you have a resistance which you have for the purpose. So you have a, for example, this is a resistance. Okay. Now you would like to know, for example, what is the resistance between this point and this point. Okay. But you will also know that this has been worn into thin wires. See, the thin wires are going round, and starts from that wire, if you trace it, starts from this point, goes round and round, and then comes out at this point. So you can have a resistance between these two points, you know. Now that will be the total length of that wire, area of cross section, and the material that is used. And we often use it for variable resistance. You can also have, you change it, and so in between, so you have a tapping point somewhere here, so you can have between this to this point will be from starting from here and up to this point. So you can change the resistance. Okay. So that is how you have a variable resistance. All it does is, it doesn't change anything except the length between the terminals. Okay. So whenever such a resistance is there, then it will follow this pattern. And the this resistance is also specified. It says amps 4, ohms 53. Okay. Therefore, this cannot take normally more than 4 amperes of current, and its maximum value is 53 ohms. Okay, that has been measured. So across it, you can apply 53 into 4, right? So around 215, 212, that volts, right? So this is again a very trivial and simple thing about the resistance. So to recall, if you want to see this, whatever I had prepared it, these are the informations which we have already covered. Just to recap, right? So you have resistance V by I. Resistance is by design rho L by A. Rho is this, L is this, and A is this. And we have V equal to Ri, and I is equal to V by R, root 2 by R, V cos omega t, then root 2 I cos omega t. And we have the V phasor and I phasor, and we finally come out to V equal to Ri, and V and I are phasors. And V can be anywhere, I will follow. Okay. Now, let us go to another important element. What is that? Inductance. Fine. So, start meditating on inductance. I'll ask some questions. Meanwhile, we'll have a 1 or 2 minutes break if you have any questions, because I was told that the students in the other class also need some clarifications. Okay. You get DC, you pass a DC. How do you measure a resistance? Is if you put AC, you can't measure resistance. See, by definition, whenever there is a steady current flowing at any instant, that voltage by current is the resistance. That's why we call it a steady. Extremely simple, and you must have 100% of absorption of this knowledge. Okay. Now, let us go to. Apparently, there was no resistance to this knowledge. Okay. And before we go to inductance, we know that resistance is a function of temperature, isn't it? Now, as you increase the temperature, the resistance goes up, and from 0 degrees centigrade to, okay, then you can go down also, right? And the other way, then what happens? So you are expected to get negative, no negative resistance. Resistance will say you are expected to get a so called superconducting situation. Where?
When it becomes superconductor, there is a sudden drop in resistance.
Yeah, this is just a electrical engineer's, it's not a physics point of view. All we need is I want something which has a very minimum resistance or zero resistance, so that I can, with a small voltage, I can pump in thousands of amperes of current. Okay. That is what electric engineers are looking forward to from physicists, and physicists are still in the laboratory stage. Okay. That superconducting generators, large alternators have been thought of. In fact, they are hoping for superconductors to come so that you can have magnetically levitated trains to go in jet speeds. Okay. So there are a lot of applications sought of for superconductors. So they are hoping if superconductors can be obtained at room temperature, that is an ideal condition. Okay. So you don't apply any voltage, you get lot of current. Okay. Right. So let us see the. We normally have an inductance of a coil, isn't it? So we have, maybe I will write a coil, maybe wound on a core with n turns. Okay. This is the coil, and this may be a core. Inductance is a electromagnetic device. It's an electromagnetic device which you create by windings at turns on a magnetic structure. And we are interested to know if this is represented by an inductance L, and if you pass a current, apply a voltage V, what will be the nature of current? This is our interest now. Okay, what do you define as an inductance? Who can answer correctly? Only he should raise the hand. I want someone to define an inductance. Yes.
A coil mounted on a hollow cylinder so that magnetic field generated constant.
I want a definition of an inductance. That is not the definition. You have told everything other than the definition. How do you define an inductance? Right. Okay. So in other words, inductance is, by definition, inductance is the ratio of flux linkage to current. So when you pass a current through a coil, it produces a flux. Okay. So if you pass a current I through the coil, it produces a flux phi. Let us say phi is the flux. This produces a flux, and I define L as, I have not told flux, but I have told flux linkage. What is flux linkage? Flux into number of turns. Okay, that is flux linkage lambda by I. We call it as flux linkage lambda and the current I. Flux linkage by current. Lambda by I. Flux linkage is N phi by I. So same flux, if you have one turn, flux linkage is phi. Two turns, flux linkage is 2 phi. 100 turns, flux linkage is 100 phi. So you please be very clear about these definitions from now onwards. So from now onwards, all of you must be able to define an inductance at all time to come. Okay, that is flux linkage per unit current N phi by I. Okay. Now, if this is the flux linkage, voltage across this is given by the Faraday's law. That is, the change of flux linkage with time is the voltage. Okay? He said, Faraday found out that whenever any coil there is a flux linkage changes, a voltage suddenly comes across. Okay? So, that is d lambda by dt, which in this case will be n d phi by dt. I will come to that later. Okay, well, plus minus dispute will be there all. Okay, I'll tell you how the plus minus disputes is a perpetual confusion. Okay, so we'll sort out the confusion a little later. Okay, now even AC voltage, in fact, a good question was that AC voltage, we must also give some type of a direction to it. Voltage, we mean something, you know, when you say a voltage is like this, because if you root the other way around, it will be opposite of that voltage, even in AC. Okay, we have a reference. Now, this will be equal to L di by dt, because your lambda is Li, isn't it? Because lambda is Li, therefore you have L di by dt. Now, suppose if you say I is some root 2 times the magnitude RMS into, let us say, sine omega t, and by this definition, voltage will be root 2 times omega L I cos omega t. Is it okay? So we have, if this is I, this is V by our definition. Okay. So if you plot these two, let us say I is a sine wave, then V is a cosine wave, and you find the phase angle between them is 90 degrees. So what is interesting is, whenever the voltage is peak, current is zero. When current is peak, voltage is zero. Okay? And you will notice that the product of the two over any cycle will be zero. Product of voltage and current, if you integrate from in one cycle, it will be zero. So it does not take any power at all. An ideal inductance will not take any power over a period. Okay? There may be instantaneous power, but there is no average power. Whereas resistance is a power absorbing element, whereas inductance is not a power absorbing element. It can store energy for a period, and but it will give it back if it is an ideal or a faithful inductance. Okay? I mean, these are the concepts which you are expected to know. Right? Like the ideal inertia in a mechanical system. Okay. Now, with this, we have we can write I phasor and V phasor. So, what will be I phasor now? And what will be V phasor? By that definition, I phasor will be I into e to the power of minus j pi by 2. So its magnitude into the power of minus j pi by 2, and v is of course the magnitude v, because e to the power is a cosine function. We always say cosine omega t is at 0. Therefore, we can have a voltage phasor along the x axis or the real axis and a current phasor. Good, you start getting doubts. Okay. This one can be written as root 2 times real of I e to the power of minus j pi by 2 e to the power of j omega t. E to the power of real of e to the power of j omega t minus pi by 2 is sin omega. Okay, therefore we have already defined this whole thing is my phasor, right? You remove all those things, root 2 and e to the j omega, it is understood. Whereas same thing here, therefore we write like this. Okay, please. And when we have this, and we also got a relation, please, what is V in terms of I now? In terms of I will be omega L into I, magnitude wise. And we define omega L as inductive reactance equal to XL. So we define it as a reactance, and we can easily write from this, we know that V and I RMS values are related like this. Multiply I by omega L, you get the RMS value of the voltage. So if you have an RMS current across an inductance, RMS voltage will be multiplied that by XL. So V magnitude wise is XL into magnitude of I. But we know that V is given by, because of this, we can say V phasor will be J times XL into I phasor. So this is what we write. V phasor is always equal to J times XL into I phasor. So this is an important relation you must know. By now you must understand what is the reactance, what is an inductance. Mind you, all the time my XL is real. Please note down, XL is always real. It is not imaginary inductance. No imaginary reactance. We are only trying for this phasor operation, we multiply by J to make sure of this operation. So we know that, we are very clear that voltage is always leading the current by 90 degrees in inductance. Okay? Yes?
Yeah.
Right.
So it should be pi by 2 is positive and minus cos
of minus. Cos of minus theta is cos theta. Okay?
But if inductance leads current.
No, no, no. This is right. Okay? That will happen in capacitance. Okay? Right? You just work it out. What is being done is right. So we get to this conclusion that in a resistor, voltage is in phase with the voltage, with the current. In an inductor, voltage leads degrees. Okay, our current lags voltage by 90 degrees. Okay, or if you define phi as the angle between voltage and current, what we normally call it as the phase angle between voltage and current, in this case is minus 90 degrees. Whereas in the resistance, it is 0 degrees. Okay, so we have, what is the, how does the inductance again decide it? Like a resistor is also decided by design, so inductance also should be decided by design. Okay. Inductance is decided by design. And we can prove, but of course we'll do it a little later, is equal to N square into this is the formula for inductance by design of a typical coil, where N is number of turns and L is this length. L is the length of flux path. And A is the area across the cross section of the area of cross section. And we define mu is the permeability of the medium, magnetic permeability. So you can increase an inductance of a coil by increased number of turns, or use a high permeability material, or decrease the length of the path. So we have an inductance, a coil. Of course, it is this is a terminal. Of course, there is a coil which is wound across this core. Okay, in fact, it's wound like this. It's a central limb where the is closed. So it is also can be also used as a transformer. In fact, this is shown here. This has a resistance, inside it has a resistance also, and about the inductance of 17 Henry's. Okay, so that is decided by the design of the thing. So we have seen the resistance and the inductance, and the next class we will go to the capacitor and the combination of these.